Very much welcome once again to our series of seminars at the Swedish Institute of International Affairs. We are starting off this autumn within our programs, which, as you know, are Europe, Russia, Eurasia, Middle East, North Africa, Asia, and global issues, with a seminar that touches on quite a number of these programs, but embedded in our Middle East and North Africa program. We are addressing an issue of the role of the Kurdish movements, the identity and future of the Kurdish people, an issue that is really at the center of what is happening around one of our age's most important conflicts. We are looking to the Kurdish movements to see whether we can not only recognize their interests, but also see what they can bring to the broader Middle East. And we have a fantastic panel here today. I'm very thankful to my colleagues who have brought all of you together. You can see who they are here. We have first Omar Sheikhmus, who is a political scientist, longtime resident here in Sweden, author and Middle East analyst. We have Cengiz Çandar, who has come to visit us out of the troubles in Turkey. He's a lecturer at the Swedish Defense University now, and as well a recognized Middle East analyst. We have Bita Hammargren, who I think landed at midnight or something like this back from Beirut, and well known to all Swedes, but with some broad perspectives to share with us. She is, of course, as you know, the editor of utrikesmagasinet.se, which I hope you all read and contribute to, many of you in this enlightened audience. And why don't you, by the way, use hashtag UIEvent as you go through this so we get some greater traction for all of it. And to end the panel, we have Idris Ahmedi, who is a PhD and lecturer at the Swedish Defense University in this very building, and another prominent Middle East analyst. Very much welcome to you all. So, applause to everyone. So, may I ask Omar that you address us all for 10 minutes or so to enlighten us to the fundamental perspectives of the movements.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. It's nice seeing so many being here on a Monday afternoon. I will try to be as simple as possible. The Kurdish question is confusing even for us, not only for you, with all these symbols and complicated matters. I've only taken here the main organizations that exist in each part of Kurdistan, or where the Kurds live in the Middle Eastern states. And there are other minor parties, but I will take the major ones. There is the PKK in Turkey, to start with. There is a KDP section of Turkey as well. Then there is a newly formed organization that's called PAK, which is Partia Azadi Kurdistan, which is the Kurdistan Freedom Party. And then there is a historical organization that used to be called still called the Socialist Party of Turkish Kurdistan, which was led by a famous poet and writer, Mr. Kemal Borkai, but he's not the chairman anymore. He's the chairman of another party called Hakpar. And then you have all heard about HDP, that was led by Salahaddin Demirtas, which is the political and civil organization that is affiliated with the PKK and gained 12% of the votes in the June 2015 elections. Then, of course, in all parts of Kurdistan since the 80s, I haven't put them on the board. We have had a number of Islamic movements, Islamic parties that are a new phenomena that were established, some by Iran, support from Iran, some by support from Saudi Arabia, some are indigenous. But they were not part of the Kurdish nationalist discourse or movement before, but now they are quite active to a number of factors that we can take up later on. In Syria, you have two main organizations. One is called Tafdam, and PYD is the major organization. They are affiliated to PKK as well. Then you have the other, a number of, a coalition of 11 parties that's within the Kurdish National Council of Syria. And it will be too tedious to go through each one of them. In Iraqi Kurdistan, the three main organizations are PUK, KDP, and Goran, which is the change movement. The change movement used to be within the PUK, but it's split away in 2009. In Iran, we have the historical organization that's called Kurdistan Democratic Party in Iran. Then we have an affiliate of PKK that's called PJAK. I think it's called KADO now. And then we have, again, a historical organization which was established. It's a leftist one in 1969, which is called KOMALA. There are different versions. And then there are smaller organizations that are called different things. In order not to take too much time, what do these Kurdish movements want? Well, we can divide it into three historical periods, more or less. One is that after the First World War, the majority of the Kurdish organizations were demanding independence, and they were fighting for independence. After the Second World War, because the movements did not succeed, whether it was in the 1920s and 30s, and the 40s, there was a change of platform and policy, and they were more or less, they became much more mild and timid by asking for self-governance, autonomy, or very lately federation, right up to the 80s. But now we can see there is a certain confidence and assertiveness compared to earlier periods where the demand for independence is merging again. Now, what's happening as far as their role in the region and in regional politics is concerned? As the period of the strong unitary central governments has more or less changed in the Middle East, and you can find a number of failed states or much more loosened states like Lebanon, Yemen, Libya, Syria, and Iraq. You find that the number of these regional actors are becoming much more important in playing a bigger role in the politics of these countries. And therefore, we find that the Kurds changing from a very timid little brother profile into a much more confident and assertive regional actor due to the weakening of the central states and the importance of the role that they are playing in the fight against the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria. In Turkey, it's a different question. And I'll leave that to my colleague, Cengiz Çandar, who will talk about that later on. And therefore, we are seeing now that I remember very well from the 1970s when I told a friend of mine at the political science department that the United States is involved in the Kurdish movement in Iraq. He couldn't believe it. He said, what would a superpower like the United States has to do with a very minor ethnic group in a small corner of the Middle East? But now we are seeing that the superpowers, whether it's the United States, Russia, Europe, and others, are paying a lot of attention to the role that the Kurds are gradually gaining and the importance that they are gaining as political actors in the Middle East. And thank you.
Thank you very much for introducing our seminar with this perspective. The Kurds are, as we know, a people with a language, a culture, an identity, and a history spanning different regions, perhaps possibly the largest people without state identity in the world. This is what we are talking about. We are turning now to Cengiz Çandar. You, sir, have been a journalist for a very long time. Turkish newspapers globally often taking positions that have angered the one or the other, and we are very proud to have you here. I should say even more about you, but I think half the audience knows who you are. Very much welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Could you direct the mic towards?
Yes.
Thank you.
I think it's audible, no? Yes. Well, thank you for the very caressing introduction. I hope I don't disappoint those who know me otherwise. Actually, as you may all aware, that this year is the 100th anniversary of the Sykes-Picot Treaty. It was in May 1916, and since it has been the 100th anniversary of the Sykes-Picot, there were many conferences, panels, symposiums, seminars all over the world concerning the future of the Middle East, with a reference to its past, because Middle East is everybody's worry and concern and area of interest. So there has been a multiple occasions to commemorate and to debate on the Sykes-Picot. As you are all aware again that it is a very infamous treaty, a notorious one. It is considered as the mother of all evils concerning the Middle East, which is highly debatable whether whatever existing in the Middle East is a real product of Sykes-Picot, which has never been implemented, actually. There were other treaties that followed Sykes-Picot, but the blame is put on Sykes-Picot, at least because of the reason that it has been the first of its kind, although it was a secret deal, of the intentions of the Western colonialist nations to partition the region of the Middle East, which was for 400 years until the Ottoman domination was a single political, administrative, and economic unit. So there is nobody in the Middle East who are not against the Sykes-Picot. All the Arab nationalists are against. They think that they have it has divided the Arab nation, although I'm not sure if Arabs really need to be divided other than to be to have Sykes-Picot in the past. But Islamists as well, the political Islamists are very much against Sykes-Picot. If you recall the so-called caliph of the ISIS, the Islamic State, which overrunning the city of Mosul in Iraq, who declared ISIS as the Islamic State, in his first sermon from the mosque in Mosul, he had said that the borders of Sykes-Picot is undone. So even for the Salafi, jihadist, Islamist, Sykes-Picot is a big evil to be undone. And for others, for the Turks, for the authorities of my country, including above anybody else, as always has been the case, President Tayyip Erdogan, whenever he speaks, he refers on the region, he always makes a reference to Sykes-Picot that it has to be overcome. Because, after all, for those Turks who want to resurrect the glory of the Ottoman Empire, Sykes-Picot is the treaty that partitioned it. But everybody forgets about the Kurds. Actually, it divided the Arabs, it separated the Turks from the Arabs, it divided the Muslims, even the Christians and everything bad that or evil one could think of, but it actually divided the Kurds more than anybody else, because if in a jokingly way, if we make a reference, in the wake of the World War I, Kurds being a single, more or less, a single ethnic community in current three countries of the region, like Turkey, Syria, and Iraq, wake up in the morning to find themselves as subjects of Turkey, subjects of Iraq, subjects of Syria. So in order to go across their village, brother to other brother's house, son to father's or mother's house, or vice versa, they need to go miles, hundreds of miles away from their settlements in order to get a visa, if they are accorded, you know, in order to visit across their village, their kin. So it separated, it divided the Kurds more than anything else. And the moment the Kurds objected or rejected this division, they were dubbed as being divisive elements, divisive, submersive elements. So the concept Kurd, the notion Kurd, has become synonymous or equivalent with somebody being divisive, secessionist, or subversive. And later on, if they address their grievances through arms, then they have become terrorists. They transformed into become terrorists. So that has one of the most important and pressing products of the settlement of the post-World War I period. So when we come, after nearly 100 years, or exactly 100 years as we are now in it, what we see, the Kurds are moving into the stage of history as they had never been so. When we look around, we see in Iraq a Kurdish self-rule, short of a full independence. Actually, they are acting like an independent entity, but short of having a flag and a seat in the United Nations. Other than that, it's a quasi-independent entity, what they have in a good part of northern Iraq. So now they are under violent and volatile and war conditions in Syria, in northern part of Syria. They exercise a certain sort of a self-rule as well. And in Turkey, despite all, they have over 100 municipalities. They have elected mayors, although they are being overruled in the last period that Turkey is passing through. And their party, if we would call it, not legally, but as the perception, their party does have 59 members in the Turkish parliament, which makes it the third largest parliamentary bloc in the Turkish legislative body. So I'm leaving aside Iran. It's another issue, and I don't want to take your time, so I will be focusing on this evolutionary picture and focus on what Turkey is doing, as Omar Sheikh Mus put me the burden upon my shoulders, and then I will conclude. In this respect, when we see this new Kurdish presence in the stage of history, in regard to the volatile region of the Middle East, we can think of it from my country's positioning to this happening in the region, because after all, if I go back to the initial introductory part of my statement, I made a reference to Sykes-Picot. That was the post-Ottoman period. So being the inheritors of the Ottoman state, whatever concerns the region and includes the Kurds, the Turkish national state do have a role in acting and reacting to the happening. And the reaction of the current Turkish state has become very negative. So what I want to bring into your attention, that I feel that most of the people all over the world, not in this country, in my country, all over, misses, is a very important statement of President Tayyip Erdogan, which was made in January, on the very date, 27 January 2015, which he repeated today, literally today, on his way to take part in the Syrian refugees summit to be held tomorrow and after tomorrow in New York. What he said to the accompanying journalist coming back from a state visit that he had paid to Somalia, he said during the conversation, and I'm emphasizing the date, it is January 27, 2015, nearly 2 years ago. He said, we cannot let what has happened in northern Iraq, in northern Syria, he said. So this is the wording he picked up. We cannot let what has happened in northern Iraq to be repeated in northern Syria. It will be very heavy burden for us, for Turkey, to resist, but we have to. Because it will be very problematic in the future if the Kurds from Afrin, crossing over to Kobani, all the way to Mediterranean, or from Kamishli, all the way to Kobani, and going all the way towards Mediterranean, we cannot accept it. So the repetition of northern Iraq, despite what he said, northern Iraq is today's KRG and its presidency, Mesut Barzani and the government are the best friends of Turkey in the region. But making a reference to history, it is still a bad precedent. Despite the close friendship with Turkey, it's a bad precedent for Turkey to have a similar entity next to its next doors on the other part of its borders. Actually, it's the longest border. It is over 900 kilometers between Turkey and Syria. And both sides of the border, mostly, not in every corner, in every inch, but mostly populated by the Kurds. So with the infectious impact, which is presumably would come from northern Syria, what people now refer as Rojava, would be unacceptable for Turkey. There would be a Kurdish corridor stretching from the borders of Iran all the way to Mediterranean, cutting Turkey's direct relations with the Arab world, with the Middle East and elsewhere. So it is not acceptable, it is not permissible. Therefore, what is to be done is what Turkey is doing today, interfering, sending its military, and today, literally today, on his way to United Nations Syrian Refugee Summit meeting, again, during a press conference he held before he left Turkey, he said, we told to Americans so many times, again in New York, we will be telling once again that for Syria, we from the very beginning we had asked three things: no-fly zone, security zone, and train and equip in terms of our cooperation, military cooperation with the Americans. Train and equip the opposition that Turkey will be serving as an umbrella. So now what we are seeing in Syria, since nearly a month, Turkish forces are within the territory of Syria. And today, President Erdogan emphasized that they say that we have to stop at a certain point. We will decide where to stop. Nobody else could decide on behalf of us. And it is well known that the Turkish outlook is a 90-kilometer wide corridor from one canton all the way to the other canton of Rojava to control the entire area and go deep nearly 40-45 kilometers to the south to the environs of the city of Aleppo, which means effectively Turkey will scuttle, if it can, any sort of a Kurdish autonomous being to emerge in the western part of, as everybody calls it, the river Euphrates. So either Kurds will reconcile themselves, if there is an ultimate resolution of the Syrian situation, to have an autonomous body to the eastern part of Syria, or as an Israeli analyst, which I will refer now and then complete my words here, Israeli military intelligence formerly, and has been the vice chairman of the National Security Council, acting as an advisory body to the Israeli Prime Minister. Now he's working with Begin Sadat Center in Tel Aviv. Dr. Eran Lerman is his name. And he said, he wrote an article under the title, "The Turks in Syria and Kurds in Rojava." There he says the policy being followed by Turkey nowadays coincides with the intentions and the positions of Russia, actually. So what he has written, quote, "Turkey's new policy could be covertly in line with Russian designs to help Assad weaken his most effective enemies and then regain control of large parts of Syria hitherto considered irretrievably lost. This could be translated into further military pressure on the Kurds with the ultimate object of destroying their hold everywhere in northeastern Syria." So, here we come. If I go to the introductory part of what I've said, that the Kurds came as never they had been to the stage of history, particularly comparing what had become of them with Sykes-Picot. Now they are in the stage of history, but yet still we do not know how destiny will unfold for the Kurds. And recalling what has happened to the Armenians just again 100 years ago in more or less in the same regional area, there is nothing as a done deal for the future of the Kurds. It is very much linked to, as has been prior to Sykes-Picot, big power politics, what will come up, what will come out from mainly American and Russian, if they would be able to reach a deal in the region, or until a big historical deal to be reached in the region, which will cover and define the fates of every segment of the peoples of the region, including the Kurds. So with this big question mark concerning the fate and the future of the Kurds, I leave the floor to my colleagues. Thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you very much. Cengiz, thank you very much. You're the author of a book, Mesopotamia Express, that I believe have sold quite well. And all of us here, well, I don't speak for anyone else, but I'd get on the first train from Istanbul to Baghdad the day we can travel the distance. Let's see what historical deal that is possible. I never tire to blame the invasion of Iraq for a lot of ills that we are facing today, but one of the positives that have come out of it is, of course, the stabilizing effect of the Kurdish region in North Iraq. Let's see where we can go, but you highlighted the challenges. And now I turn to Bitte. Bitte, you've been fantastic in coming to our institute and sharing your extensive knowledge. You've just come back from the region with perspectives on what is possible, less possible, and impossible in the near future. Please share with us.
Thank you, Mats, and probably I will be more focusing on what is not possible for reasons, because I just left Beirut as the ceasefire in Syria was crumbling, as you know. And allow me to use the wide angle here on the area, zooming out sort of and reflecting as to what analysts from Syria and Lebanon and the region are saying about the current situation. If we try to look ahead about 6 months from now, what will be the case on Syria, which is, I mean, on the core problem now with the Kurdish issue? Well, the war will go on, most probably, for various reasons. And one of the reasons is that among the allies you have in the region, in Syria, there is practically no real, the big powers don't have strategic allies in the region. They have tactical allies with the Kurds or with Assad or with other groups, rebels, which makes it so volatile and fluid. And if we take the case of Russia, for instance, I mean, Russia is there in Syria for various reasons. They are there because they want to be recognized as a world power again after the isolation on Ukraine. And they want to hold back the Sunnis in the Caucasus. But this has backfired on Russia because the airstrikes of Russian and the Assad regime's Sunni civilians has forced many of those people into the extremist camps, meaning Daesh or Nusra. Some or many or most unwillingly. And Syrians who have fled from the Daesh area, they told me that many people there have joined because Daesh would pay better and because they don't trust Assad or the Kurdish YPG. Other Syrian Arabs would say that, well, yes, we can live with the Kurds and they do have minority rights. So the issue is blurred. And let me come back to that later. I would also say that Russia does have an interest to destabilize the European Union because of the sanctions, and many would argue that they've been using the flood of refugees to Europe to do this. And they've got a stronger foothold in the Middle East by allying with Bashar al-Assad. But on the other hand, Russia will face a huge problem even if Assad lingers on. The jihadists will be energized by Assad keeping in power in Damascus and energized by his war crimes while they're committing their war crimes. And the Kurds are in between. And then we have the war economy, which has not been maybe elaborated enough, but nobody really wants to invest in Syria, even if there would be a ceasefire that would prevail for some time. The regime has emptied its coffers, and they're not having enough army soldiers to fight everywhere. So what they've done is that outsourced the militias, and militias who are held accountable to nobody. And they are practically using the same methods as Baghdad, the Iraqi government, is doing by its way of outsourcing power to militias who are fighting the Sunni Arabs, which again throw them into the arms of the hardliners. So Assad will do better in a war than in a transition period and peace, analysts in Beirut say. Iran and Russia do have the same tactical ally, Bashar al-Assad, but this is not a strategic axis. They differ on the view on the Kurds and on Israel. So then if we move the picture to the United States, the US has lost its orientation in the region. No single party in this conflict really trusts the United States. The US policy is not consistent. I mean, they've been supporting Ankara, the Free Syrian Army, and the Kurdish militia, the YPG, and this simply isn't consistent. We saw this recently on the video footage when US special forces entered a place in northern Syria, Ara'i, with Turkish troops, and when they were forced to flee after Free Syrian Army soldiers called them crusaders, invaders, pigs, and dogs. And I'm sure Idris will add up more to this. But if we then take the US election on which everybody is focusing right now. So what if Trump will win the elections? He will side maybe with Putin on Russia. It's still not possible for Assad to control all of his country. Hillary Clinton was interventionist in 2012. Will she be that in 2017? Maybe not, because she burnt her fingers on Libya and in Syria. So what is the outlook? Mosul, Raqqa, the places where the jihadists are having their stronghold. Well, I mean, they're still waiting to see if these towns will be liberated. And what prevents them are various cases. One of them is that it will lead to an increase of refugees. Iraq already has 3 million internal displaced persons. If Mosul will be liberated, there might be another 1 million refugees. And Raqqa is a similar problem. But we also have the issue of who will then control these places. Mosul, second largest city in Iraq, close to the Kurdish region, and Raqqa, close to Rojava. Well, the Sunni Arabs mistrust the Kurds here because they always say that whenever the Kurdish Peshmerga or the militia or the fighters go into a place, they always claim it as theirs. So we have a historical mistrust between the party and the region. I don't know if I have time left.
Yes.
If we take another very important force in the region, Hezbollah. I mean, the Assad regime would not have been able to keep territory in Syria without Hezbollah, ally of Iran. And they have taken a really heavy toll in the region. There are no official figures, but people estimate casualties between 1,000 up to 2,000. Iran is certainly there, but Assad is not their strategic partner. It's Hezbollah and Baghdad. They need Bashar al-Assad for the transport connecting routes. But they will stay on to him. And as long as Iran is there in the region, the Saudi Arabia will continue to feed and finance different rebel fighters, from the Salafi to other groups. I don't need to mention anything about Turkey. Genghis has done so already, and not on Sèvres or Sykes-Picot. But when the dust settles in the region, what will it look like? Well, very few people expect Syria to remain a centralized country the way it used to be. So, and maybe the borders will also crumble. Increasingly, I hear Syrians from various ethnic groups and factions, including Sunnis who don't have a love affair with Daesh, that they see a divided, federalized Syria as a solution. And this might give some hope for the diversity of Syria in the future. There is, as a Syrian analyst told me, no going back. Decentralization is the future for Syria. And Kurds deserve a recognition as a minority in Syria, with language rights, and Christians and other minorities do that as well. They must be protected. But the mistrust between Sunni Arabs and Kurds must be handled. And between Kurds and Turkey, obviously, peace must be restored. But we are so far from there. And there is also another issue which is striking, because now when there is so many different layers of fighting in the region, the issue is also about us. Who is the nation? Who constitutes the we in a nation building? And the region has yet to answer the question if there will be a stable peace and a future where minorities will have rights within a decentralized state or within states with changing borders. Thank you.
Thank you, Bitte. I breathe deeply. The issues are not unknown, but how difficult can it be to get there? Idris, Ahmedi, well, please enlighten us.
Yeah, well, one advantage with all this complexity is that if you organize an event on the Kurds, you simultaneously have an event on Iran, Turkey, and Syria, and Russia, and the United States as well, by the way.
What about Europe?
Well, Finland
was,
and Sweden,
that
I would
facetious.
Say.
That was facetious. I'm sorry. Yeah. Please go on.
Okay. My task is to elaborate on the two models of Kurdish self-rule that exist in the Middle East. One in what the Kurds would say southern Kurdistan or Iraqi Kurdistan, the other one in western Kurdistan or in Syria. And I would like to provide a context. Most of the discussion on the Middle East, and especially on the Kurds, revolve around the notion of the balance of power. But I believe it is also important to highlight the role of ideas. And in this regard, one could point to something which is quite puzzling. And the puzzling phenomenon is that the Kurds have long been stigmatized as primitive, yet it has turned out to be that they are more susceptible to ideas of democracy, liberty, toleration, and so on. And the question then, of course, is how is it that while the Kurds are more susceptible to these ideas, whereas political Islam or radical Islam seems to dominate both at sub-state and in certain states at state level, Iran, for example, since 1979, Turkey, it appears increasingly to be going in that direction. But we also have, of course, Iraq, where political Islam is dominating at state and sub-state level. As a matter of fact, it was the Kurds that prevented Iraq from being turned into a full-fledged theocracy in 2005, when they insisted that Islam shouldn't be written as the sole source of lawmaking in the constitution. In any case, my simple answer is that the reason why the Kurds are more susceptible, or as some would say, much more progressive or susceptible to progressive ideas than their neighbors, has nothing to do with the Kurdish DNA. It rather has to do with three factors. One is the existence of Kurdish municipalities from the 15th century until the 19th century, where several municipalities dominated Kurdish political life and they were keen about preserving their autonomy. The second one has to do with the fact that democratic ideas have survived thanks to the survival of Kurdish movements since the beginning of the 20th century. I mean, one of the oldest Kurdish political organizations, Democratic Party of Iranian Kurdistan, which was established in 1947, has consistently called for democracy and liberty, and recently some kind of federalism or power-sharing arrangement in Iran. But the other one, and this is reflected in the PKK and its various affiliates, and that's the survival of leftist ideas in the Kurdish movement. That's why we see so many women in the ranks of the PKK. Some say 40% of PKK fighters, and perhaps even more of YPG fighters in Syria, are actually female. So this ideological context is extremely important to consider when we want to understand the two models of Kurdish self-rule. And of course, the first model was the one that was established in Iran, in Iranian Kurdistan in 1946, and only survived for 11 months. But even Persian scholars acknowledge that back then, democratic ideals, considerations about gender equality and so on, was reflected in the short-lived Kurdish Republic. But I would say that If I may be a little bit boring and make political science relevant, I would like to mention Francis Fukuyama, who received the August Hütteprise, the Swedish equivalent to the Nobel Peace Prize in political science. And Fukuyama, he has this interesting idea that the reason why we see so much instability in the so-called third world is that in the Western context, we have seen the establishment of strong institutions, state institutions. By strong state institutions, it means institutions capable of providing education, healthcare, you know, creating infrastructure and so on. And once in the Western context, strong institutions were created, the bourgeoisie, the emergence of the bourgeoisie resulted in calls for the creation of rule of law, or for rule of law and constitutional government. And it is actually only later that in the Western context democracy has been introduced. In the third world, we don't have strong institutions, and certainly we don't have rule of law in many countries, but democracy has been tried. And what has been the result? Well, the result has usually been instability. And this has a direct bearing on Iraqi Kurdistan, because Iraqi Kurdistan, when the Kurdish government was established, they immediately tried to hold elections. Now, the problem was that you hold elections against the backdrop of the Anfal campaign, which was the genocidal campaign by the former Iraqi government or the Iraqi state against the Kurdish people. You had Kurdish infighting, and you had a severe economic situation. Ultimately, this resulted in civil war between 1994 until 1998, when the United States intervened and managed to put an end to the civil war. But what has emerged, especially following 2003, thanks to oil revenues, thanks to a strategic agreement between the two main Kurdish actors, KDP and PUK, but I would also like to add, thanks to the presence of the United States, we have seen some kind of stability in Iraqi Kurdistan. But this stability is compromised, and it has been compromised due to three factors. One is the budgetary problems. Basically, Iraq has since Maliki's time, been waging an undeclared economic warfare against the Kurdistan region by basically not giving them their share of the Iraqi state budget. The second one is the emergence of ISIS. And the third one is that Uncle Sam, the United States, by leaving Iraq in 2011, no longer has a stabilizing role as an external power. So what we have in Iraqi Kurdistan, if we're going to define the model that exists there, it is a rudimentary form of democracy where pluralism is one of its facets, where there is a circumscribed but nevertheless existing liberal public sphere where people can, you know, make their voices heard without being put in jail. You have this problem where PUK and KDP dominated the political scene, but then Goran came on the scene and the system has become much more unstable since then. But also, of course, the role of personalities in Kurdish politics is also important to consider, and that's the role of Mam Jalal or Jalal Talabani, former president of Iraq and the leader of PUK. He has disappeared from the political scene due to illness, and this has added to the instability in Iraqi Kurdistan. So if we are going to look ahead, what are the challenges for Iraqi Kurdistan after the defeat of Daesh or ISIS? Well, most analysts would say that probably there is going to be a new war, and the new war is going to be between Peshmerga and the so-called Shiite militias, some of which are actually controlled by Iran. The other one major challenge is that unless PUK and Goran somehow reach an agreement with KDP, we are likely to see instability in Iraqi Kurdistan. And then, of course, the third challenge is the budgetary challenge. If you cannot find a solution, a long-term solution to oil revenue as the major source of income by, say, diversifying the economy, you will always have a constant source of instability in Iraqi Kurdistan. Now, if I turn to the second model, the in the one in Syria. The one in Syria, unlike the one in Iraqi Kurdistan, has been dominated by one political party, the PYD, and its political wing, the YPG. So unlike Iraqi Kurdistan, you actually have a monopoly on the use of force, and you have this one-party domination. The advantage with the Iraqi Kurdish model is that you have some kind of, you know, some form of rudimentary democracy, but you absolutely have liberty, you have tolerance, you have pluralism. In the model that exists in Syria, because of the dominance of PYD, you don't have the same level of pluralism. But unlike Iraqi Kurdistan, the advantage is that due to the monopoly on the use of force by the Kurdish forces there, you have no reason to be concerned about internal fighting or civil war, and you have a stability that could be expected if external conditions are favorable. But as with the external challenges to Iraqi Kurdistan, the major external challenge to the Kurdish government or the Kurdish system that is emerging in Syria is, of course, Turkey. Because Turkey would like to ideally to create conditions whereby this government is totally destroyed. But Turkey could also envisage a situation where they could undermine it effectively. And they will do it by either intervening directly, which they have been doing, but most likely they will try to support groups to target the emerging Kurdish self-rule in Syria. And most likely, after the defeat of Daesh, we will see groups allied with Turkey fighting with the Kurds. So these are the prospects, the characteristics of these two models and the kind of challenges that they face. And I'll end there.
Thank you very much, Idris. Look, this is an extremely interesting and challenging picture. Thank you very much, all four of you, for a very deep picture. We have the image of what is happening in terms of political governance in the areas that are controlled by Kurdish institutions. We have the broader setting where Kurdish impetus is important to the outcome. And of course, we have the even broader picture of what everyone else can do in the greater good. I am going to let the audience get at you before you start talking to yourselves. So I'm going to invite your questions. But before that, I'm going to, I've got one there. And so please bring the mic up there to the gentleman. And there's one right there, Ylva, if you, Igor. So that we can get started. But I want to put the question to you directly so that it doesn't come from anywhere else. I mean, what about the terrorist legacy in among Kurdish movements? I think you need to speak to it because it's something that is on the minds of a lot of people, and we want to know what your assessment of that is in the past and the present. So keep that in mind as you get to the responses of the questions, but I don't want it to be unmentioned. So the gentleman over there, and please be, if you like, present yourself and be short, and then we can get a lot of questions. We still have 35 minutes.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Joel Ahlberg from the Folke Bernadotte Academy. I'd like to ask the panel, what is the situation in the discussions between the Turks and the Kurds in Iraq regarding the liberation of Mosul? Thank you.
Mosul.
Yes.
Thank you, Ari. I'm Igor Terbakov. I'm a research fellow here at this institute. Almost every speaker in the panel invoked the role of great powers in the region, particularly in Kurdistan. As a Russianist, my question is about Russia, and I would say that Russia does have a strategic interest in Kurdistan, since the relationship between Russia and the Kurds has a sort of a long history, at least since the time when Catherine the Great commissioned the publication of the Kurdish grammar back in 1787. So my question is this. Recently, Professor Michael Reynolds of Princeton published a paper with a telling title, Vladimir Putin, Godfather of Kurdistan. What's your take on this? How would you characterize Putin's gamble in Kurdistan, both Turkish Kurdistan and Syrian Kurdistan?
Okay.
Is Professor Reynolds' suggestion an overstatement? Thank you.
Mosul, Putin, and the gentleman right there.
Is he the godfather of Kurdistan? Yes, my name is Van Liet. I have a very short question. Mr. Shekmus said, and it shows my ignorance, that Sykes-Picot divided the Arabs, but it also divided the Kurds. The question that I have is basically, was the division of the Kurds collateral damage, or was it done on purpose? Thank you.
Another question?
Hello, my name is Samir. I just have one question. Is about what's the European Union's role in the Middle East, especially when it's about the Kurdish issue? Thank you.
Okay, maybe these are such great questions that I need to turn to the panel. Cengiz, are you ready to go first on some of these? To recall, we have the issue of Mosul, Russia, and whether or not... I will come to another round. The question of whether the Kurds are divided by outside or inside forces, and the question of the role of the European Union. Please take your pick, and let's make sure we have a few more rounds. But...
You know this the famous Turkish or maybe Eastern fable or the folk hero Hoca, when he has listened very disputing and conflicting and contradictory sides, when as a judge, when his verdict was asked, he had told all of them, "You are right. All of them are right." So when it comes to the controversies of the Middle East, there are such questions as the very credible questions that are raised here in this room is concerned. There is no simple and easy answer to any of them. And so any kind of speculative answer could well be very scientific. Actually, for example, I was listening very carefully to a very illuminating, with capital letters I should say so, very illuminating presentation of my dear colleague Idris Ahmedi. But to come to a conclusion at the end that the Iraqi Kurds do have grown up in a much more democratic culture than the Syrian Kurds, having pluralism in KRG, while the Kurdish self-rule in Syria is dominated by the force of arms of one party, one could think that Iraqi Kurds are much more progressive than the Syrian Kurds. And when we come to this year, 2016, that great political democratic culture of the Iraqi Kurds do not let the parliament speaker to come to enter to Erbil and to convene the parliament. And after all, when you leave the Kurds alone by themselves, quote unquote, the democratic culture ends immediately. The personalities, violence, muscle flexing, all the bad habits that they have learned from their immediate neighbors, Turks, Iranians, Arabs, are reflected there. But coming to the core of the questions, let me start from the second question. Whether I've read the article, Michael Reynolds, and like any American commercial style, it was very sexy, the title. Putin, Godfather of Kurdistan, question mark. You have to read it. When you see that title, you have to read it. But when I read the article, despite the author is a member of the staff of a very important prestigious institution like Princeton University, I didn't find much convincing and strongly supportive scientific argument in that. So it's just an American type of self-flagellation. While Trump is sending good messages to Putin, and there is this primaries that were underway at the time. So he's a Putin godfather of Kurdistan because of the weight Russia had introduced to the Syrian theater of operations at that very timing, inspired this gentleman to write such an article. Putin, godfather of Kurdistan? No, he is not. The simple answer is not. He is not because there are too many gods over the skies of Kurdistan not to let Putin to be the godfather of Kurdistan. That's the answer I could provide to that question. On the debate between the Turks and Kurds concerning the liberation of Mosul, well, I'm not sure that the real debate is between Turks and Kurds, because yes, there is given to the level of intriguing alliance, an alignment between Ankara and Erbil, and because Mosul is a Sunni center within a region torn apart by deep cleavages of sectarian strife, Turkey posing itself as the Sunni bastion of the balance of power in the region, undeclared of course, vis-a-vis Shiite Tehran, is concerned with the fate of Mosul when and if ISIS is removed from Mosul. And in that respect, there is a debate ongoing between Ankara and its closest regional ally, Erbil. But Mosul is mostly a matter between Baghdad and Erbil, as much as between Ankara and Erbil, whether Iraq will remain within the same frontiers. So the problem, the debate on Mosul cannot be addressed only whether it is evolving between the Turks and Kurds, but we have to take into consideration the Baghdad angle of the thing. And when we get into Baghdad element into that wider equation, we have to invite Tehran as well to the equation. And we have to take into consideration that the air support provided in order to retake Mosul, Washington, the United States of America, albeit that nobody believes in it. It's the only superpower. Sometimes with its presence, it's a big headache. Sometimes with its absence, it's a big headache. Whether you trust the United States or not is another issue. But in any matter which could serve as a milestone in terms of the progress of the events in the Middle East, you have to look what Washington is doing or saying or intending to do. So Mosul is, in that sense, very important. The last thing, very briefly, whether it's a collateral damage or on purpose, what has happened, what has befallen on the Kurds following Sy Spiker. If I would say on purpose, I had to subscribe myself, which I'm against, for myself at least, to conspiracy theories that the big powers wanted to divide the Kurds. I don't think the Kurds, as an element in the wider equation, is the most pressing element in the radar screen of the big powers at the time when it comes to UK or France or even to a certain extent Russia. It was not the Kurds that they would define their interests accordingly. And that's why, not in Sykes-Picot, but after the Cairo conference, that they are neglected And the Arabists in the British decision-making system from Churchill to prevailed in shaping up the map of the region. So I don't think that it was on purpose just to divide the Kurds. It was to divide the region, and the Kurds did not make themselves to be felt to be taken into consideration within this game of redefining the frontiers of the Middle East over the ashes of the defunct Ottoman Empire that prevailed 400 years in that territory. So collateral damage, I would say A, not B, A. That's what I would say. Thank you.
Thank you, Cengiz. In a way, confirmation of the double challenge of own governance and relation to others. Omar.
Yes, thank you very much, Mats. I'll start with your question, actually, because it's very interesting on the question of legacy of terrorism within the Kurdish movement. Well, actually, there was a positive aspect of the Kurdish movement historically, that it never resorted to terrorism in Iran, in Iraq, in Syria. It was only even in Turkey before, it was only in the 80s and the 90s that PKK resorted in certain periods of time to certain terror methods against their own and against Turkish installations. And that's why it was labeled as a terrorist organization. They have taken a lesson out of that, and now you see that they are targeting not civilians in Turkey in their fight, but mainly police and military installations. And you can correct me if that's not true. This is the impression that I have. There is another thing, is that there is a very interesting element that even we Kurds do not touch upon. There is sufficient empirical evidence, actually, which is very unfortunate, that a number of the suicide bombers that have carried out terrorist activities in Turkey against the Kurds and in Iraq against the Kurds are Kurdish youngsters that have been recruited by the Islamic State. There are a number of other activities that have taken place as well, but it's not organized within the umbrella framework of the Kurdish movement, so to say. But there are certain Kurdish elements that have been recruited to those. I would agree completely with Cengiz on the question of the Sykes-Picot agreement and the collateral damage, which was a very good term that you used. It was not intended. And that's why many times I tell Kurds, you know, what are you working yourselves up for? Sykes-Picot was not directed at you. It was directed at the Islamic and the Arab nationalists. But you ended up, and the most interesting thing actually, that it was not intended by Britain or France either. First, the Sykes-Picot agreement, as Cengiz said, was never implemented, not even a month after the agreement. It was the agreement in December in 1916 between Clemenceau and the Prime Minister of Britain when Clemenceau unintentionally gave away the wilayat of Mosul, not knowing that there is oil there that has been recently discovered. And this ended up actually with the division of the wilayat of Mosul that Kurdistan as well ended up in this situation. As far as being the godfather of Kurdistan, I mean, all states, all big powers have their own interests. I don't think that neither the Soviet Union nor Russia have specifically. There is a myth going on, you know, that they have been supporting the Kurdish movement quite a lot. There is a lot of historical evidence that there are contrary facts as well, like the help that the Soviet Union provided Ataturk in the 1925 movement in Turkey, and then the Russian stance as far as supporting the governments in the Middle East, now the Syrian government, for example, or the Iraqi government when they were fighting against the Kurds. So there were historical periods that the Russians or the Soviets helped. There are other historical periods where the Americans are helping like they are doing now. So it's based on their national interests and if they meet with the Kurdish interests or not. There was a very good question on the discussions between Turkey and the Iraqi Kurds on the future of Mosul. These discussions are going on. There are discussions with the Sunni Arabs as well and Turkey. And there is an element of a lot of irritation of what will happen after that. And they are trying to reach consensus before the takeover with the United States and the Iraqi government being involved before an action is taken for the liberation of Mosul. But you never know whether these conflicting interests will reach a conclusion or not. One last point, please. There is something very interesting going on in the Middle East, and we as Kurds always feel it very much. You know, you look at the level of conflict of interests between these states, Turkey, Iran, Turkey, Syria, Iraq, and Turkey. But yet, when it comes to the Kurdish question, they very easily reach an agreement. Now, when there is a discussion of the Kurds in Iraq taking a step towards referendum and establishing possibly an independent state, which is just a discussion, or the formation of a federative region in Syria by the Kurds, immediately Turkey and Iran, Iraq and Iran, Turkey and Syria, Syria and Iraq make statements and coordination in order to hinder such a development. And this will have to always to be thought about, that despite all the level of conflict and interests that are taking place, they agree on the question of hindering the Kurds in reaching their aims.
Thank you very much. Idris and Bitte, I'll save you for the next round of questions, and then you can come back to some of these perspectives you want to join. Here is one gentleman, please. The mic's coming this way, and I look across the audience for a few more.
Thank you very much. I'm Bakr Fattah, ambassador of Iraq. Really, I have not question, just one is very, very short commentary. Thank you for your intervention. Really, it was very interesting. But just only one commentary about Mr. Ahmadi when he talked about their democracy and in European country after the bourgeoisie, they bring the democracy for the constitutional institutions. But you have to, see the situation, this objective and subjective situation in any place and any stage of story, it's different, it's not look like. And the second in Kurdistan of Iraq after 1991, when we did election, it was a very, very important situation. And after the withdrawing of the administration by Saddam Hussein in 1991, the Kurdish was obliged to have an option. So, and before the for the competition between the political parties, so it was be solved just only by the elections. So we did the election, and the first step through the democracy. But you know that I am not very optimistic in this area in the Middle East to bring the democracy very, very short and very, very simple. It is need as a long struggle to achieve this very, very important goal, which is the democracy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Where was the... There, it's over there, please.
Yes, my name is Torbjörn Persson. I would like to ask if there are any direct links between Saudi Arabia and any Kurdish units, for instance, the northern Iraq, Kurdistan, and also in Syria. Now, that after the Islamic conference in Grozny, where, for instance, the Saudi Arabian version of Islam, the Wahhabism, the Salafism, was not accepted, do you see any less dependence or confidence in Saudi Arabia's support in Syria.
So I'm glad we got Saudi Arabia into the picture. Thank you very much. Over here.
Hi, Paul Levin, Stockholm University Institute for Turkish Studies. Thank you for a really interesting, stimulating panel. I'm just wondering if one sort of macro level perspective on all of this is that the situation in Iraq and also the civil war in Syria has been sort of a moment where the non-state actors, it was their moment in time, the Sunni rebels and the so-called Islamic State, but also the Kurdish actors, but that the international system tends to be quite conservative and not very hospitable towards non-state actors. And if we're now seeing sort of the slow, perhaps, defeat of ISIS, but that this will also affect the Kurdish movement and that the state actors will conspire to sort of defeat these challenges to the system? Question mark.
All right, you got the mega. Okay, well, let's... Okay, please. All right, the relay.
Thank you. My name is Kristina Holmström. I'm just an ordinary citizen in Sweden. I just have a very short reflection. Can war and bombs ever solve the Kurdish question? Thank you.
All right, there you go. So, the state of democracy, particularly in Iraq, the role of Saudi, non-state actors, and the ultimate question of how to get from here to where we want to be. Idris, you first,
okay,
and then Bitte.
You raise many, many good questions, and I'll only try to comment some of them. First of all, regarding the role of great powers and whether the great powers are only interested in tactical or if they have any considerations about strategic alliances in the region, I would like to say, to clarify, that alliances are built on three bases. One is common ideology, the other one is common geopolitical interests, and the third one is common threats. And what we see is that, as Paul mentioned, the world is biased toward the existing state system. Had it not been for that fact, ideologically speaking, in spite of the imperfections of the Kurds, especially the Kurdish forces in Iraq, they could have been a natural ally for the United States. Now, irrespective of this, given the fact that the United States has changed its strategy from trying to change the region or the regimes in the region to create some kind of balance of power, and given the fact that there is no consensus in the United States for having troops in the region or having long-term commitments, this means that the United States, in view of two factors, has no other choice than to rely on the Kurds. One is that they are ideologically attractive, relatively speaking, compared to the existing state and non-state actors in the region. At least they are not anti-American, and that goes a long way. The second one is that the Kurds, the Peshmerga forces, and especially YPG in Syrian Kurdistan have proven to be good fighters. So this means that from the point of the United States, and I would say from the point of view of some European countries, because they have given the US unwillingness to have an active role in the region, there is a vacuum, and the European countries would like to, because not least because of their own security considerations and because of the constant refugee flows from the region, they would like to have a more active role. So, not surprisingly, whom are they supporting in this region, especially in the war against ISIS? Well, it's the Kurdish Peshmerga. Sweden is doing it. Sweden has sent forces, which would, 15 years ago, people would not have believed that Sweden would do such a thing. Finland increased its military presence in Iraqi Kurdistan yesterday. Canada is there. Australia, to some extent, I think, has some kind of support role in this. But mostly, I would say the important actor, European actor, is Germany. They have a strong military presence in Iraqi Kurdistan. And my prediction: there is an uncertainty whether the Western support for the Kurds is apparent or real, or to put it another way, whether the Western support for the Kurds is only contingent on the war against Daesh and the outcome of the war against Daesh, or whether it will continue after the war against Daesh. This remains to be seen. But I make the prediction that given geopolitical realities in the region, and given the fact that in previous decades we had Kurdish actors that were significant, now Kurdistan as a geography is significant from a geopolitical point of view, because in Iraqi Kurdistan and in Syrian Kurdistan you have Kurdish actors controlling territory. And this means that they will continue to be important geopolitical actors, especially for the Western powers after the defeat of Daesh. And finally, regarding democracy, my point was, I actually didn't succeed to clarify, you know, this point. What Fukuyama has in mind is that Fukuyama is claiming that stable democracy requires strong state institutions and rule of law. And I would personally add even a culture of democracy. Do you believe that Sweden became Sweden over one night? Of course not. You had the creation of strong institutions, you had the rule of law, you had the Swedish bourgeoisie, and then they introduced them democratic institutions. And of course, Sweden has been very fortunate in having economic growth for decades. And this has created the kind of social and political stability and economic stability that is conducive to, you know, democracy. We don't have this in the Middle East. So let's be realistic. I'm not claiming that Iraqi Kurdistan is Sweden. Of course, Iraqi Kurdistan is not Sweden. What I'm claiming is that, relatively speaking, there is at least a willingness at elite and popular level to break with this, you know, zero-sum mentality where one group should dominate every other group. And even though the institutions are imperfect, and true, some Kurdish leaders and some Kurdish political parties do have authoritarian tendencies. It would be strange if they didn't have them, given the region they are in. But there are still differences, and I think there is reason to be hopeful about the future prospects of Iraqi Kurdistan. And one thing that is interesting about Syrian Kurdistan is the fact that women seem to have an important role to play, not only militarily, but also politically. So, to conclude, I believe that even though the Kurds are imperfect, even though, as Paul correctly pointed out, the world is biased against them, you know, it's biased toward the existing state system, geopolitical realities and the ideological conditions in the region will create conditions for future cooperation and future some form of alliance between the Western powers and the Kurds. That's my prediction.
Thank you very much, Idris. Before you go on, let me forewarn Omar and Cengiz that you'll have one other chance of concluding here, and we'll conclude at 4 o'clock, so we have 8 minutes. But just to make one comment, Idris, I'm very glad that you brought up Sweden, because so far the deep relationships between Sweden and the Kurds and Sweden and Turkey has not quite been brought up. Sweden is, after all, someone who actually cares a lot about the region, and what Swedish policy is vis-a-vis this region is very important to us, as well as what the diaspora can do in our multiple relationships. So perhaps it's quite important, but thank you for bringing it up.
By the way, Sweden is regarded as the second great power next to the United States in Kurdistan.
Well, I could comment quite spitefully on that, but let's not do that. Bitte, please.
Actually, it's true. If you travel to Iraqi Kurdistan, Swedish is a very useful language because there are so many ex-Swedish Kurds who have returned to the area. As to the question about Saudi Arabia and its influence also on the Kurdish movement, it's really interesting with this conference in Grozny that you mentioned, because the Saudi Islamic scholars were not invited and the Salafis were not invited. Of course, this makes Saudi Arabia furious. And you can see this is a sort of a new trend to try to isolate Salafism from the larger Sunni perspective. However, one must also see, as Omar mentioned, that within the Kurdish movement, you do have the ultra-conservatives also. If you travel in southeast Turkey, you can find people who are so upset about the Hudapar, who committed acts against the more secular Kurds, etc., etc. And you have among the jihadists, as Omar mentioned, Kurdish also. Idris, you mentioned about the progressiveness of the Kurdish movement, to which I would sign to a large extent, but the picture is mixed here, because among the PKK-affiliated branches in the Rojava or HDP, etc., women really have a strong role, and these women are there out of their own capacity. They're not just figureheads. However, in Iraqi Kurdistan, have you ever seen the wife of Masoud Barzani? Did she ever appear in public? Not that I know. So I think you have among the Kurds the ultra-conservative tribal traditions, and you have very progressive traditions as well. And this is the Kurdish movement. It also boils down to politics also in Iraqi Kurdistan, because, the KDP or Barzani's government is not controlling all the area. The PKK, as far as I know, is controlling the Sinjar Mountains as well as the north. So it's impossible to speak of one single Kurdish interest or vote here. May I just add on Mosul, and this would be my final remark here. In Utrikes Magazine, the magazine of which I'm an editor, we had a very interesting article about why is the liberation of Mosul delayed, and it gives a very interesting many perspectives. And one of the reasons there is that the U.S. is deliberately saying to the Kurds in northern Iraq, we want the Iraqi army to go inside and liberate Mosul. We don't want you to do the job. And everybody knows that the Iraqi army is more fragile. Thank you.
Thank you very much. 1 minute, Omar. Cengiz gets the last word.
I'll give you you are older than me.
Okay.
Okay. But just very, very briefly, that was a very interesting question and very meaningful, saying, can ever bombs and bullets solve the Kurdish question, which brought to my mind Bernard Lewis, the famous scholar on the Middle East, in his memoirs, treating on the Holocaust memoirs and making a comparison to Gandhi's style of resistance to the Brits. He entertained a notion, I'm not sure whether I remember it precisely correctly, but it said benevolent imperialism, something like that. So the Indians, led by Gandhi, was very lucky to have Britain as their adversary, as the imperialist power. If it would be Germany of 1930s that was dominating India, Gandhi's style would not work at all, perhaps. And tens of millions of Indians would be exterminated most probably. So when it comes to whether bombs or bullets can ever solve the Kurdish question, the moral instinct would say, no, it can't. But given the adversaries of the Kurds, it was very difficult to think that if the Kurds wouldn't take up arms, would we ever be debating on the Kurdish issue at all in this room at this hour? So this is an open question as well. And also, the definition of terror and terrorism is also very, very tricky. For our president, even PYD, who has been taken up arms only against Daesh until today, is a terrorist organization per se. And in any speech, he lists Daesh, PKK, PYD all together. On the same par, he treats them. I wrote a report on the decommissioning of the PKK, for example, how PKK may lay down its arms. This report could be very problematic in today's Turkey, because in the introduction I said PKK, for example, in the Turkish Kurdish case, used terror as an instrument, but using terror as an instrument in as a means to move towards your objectives should not, from the angle of political science, make one a terrorist organization, or we cannot call it terrorism. The act might be terror and terroristic, yet the organization may not be terrorist just because of using terror. So it's better to treat as an insurgent organization, it as the representative of Kurdish insurgency rather than a terrorist organization. But this merely this statement today, or maybe still is, I don't know, put me in trouble. We have in this room my dear friend Ragıp Sarakol, who is known as one of the most important publishers of Turkey. He has been in the advisory board of a pro-Kurdish daily, which is banned by the government a few days ago. And because he's in the advisory board, he's considered as being part of the terrorist network. Although he has been living in this country since more than 2 years, and he is one of the best-known peace activists in Turkey, but if he goes to Turkey today, he could be in jail. He would be in jail, not he could be. He would be in jail under the charges of being a terrorist. So when it comes to respond to your question you earlier put on, it's very difficult to treat the Kurdish organization as terrorist. For example, today's venerated president of KRG, Mr. Mesut Barzani, and the former president of Iraq, Celal Talabani, were terrorists. Only a decade ago, even in the list of the State Department of United States of America.
Thank you very much. Very serious issues. Omar, you have
the last thank you. Well, Mats, I'd like to thank the audience so much to be so well informed and come with very intelligent questions. It's extremely nice, extremely nice. On Saudi Arabia and their connections with the Kurds, the foreign minister of Saudi Arabia 3 days ago, I think, gave a press conference, and in that press conference, he mentions that they have very good relations with the Kurds in Iraq, and they are, I know, secretly trying with the Kurds in Iran because of their conflict with the Iranian government. But I'll tell you a very funny episode. When PYD, a few weeks ago, came into clashes with the Syrian government forces in Hasakah area, this is a source from PYD that has told me, that they immediately got in touch with the PYD, although they don't like them. They are very much anti-PYD. And they were inciting them to continue to fight against the Syrian government, and they will provide them with military and financial aid. This is the Middle East, so it was on the role from my colleague from the Turkish Institute, on the increasing role of non-state actors, you know very well that there has been a discussion since the 90s that the role of the nation states is being reduced in the international system, and the role of regions is increasing, and so are the roles of non-state actors, NGOs, and so on. And this was a development that continued, but we always, you know, we always think in terms, in the 1960s, we all thought that the end of religion and the role of religion in politics. But then it came back with such revenge in the 1970s and 80s until now. So you never know. The role of the nation state might take over again instead of going through this development of the withering away of the nation states, more or less, and the non-state actors would play a much bigger role. And regional actors would do the same.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, audience. Thank you, Aras Lind, who has been behind this seminar. Thank you, Omar Sheikh Mus, Peter Hamagrin, Idris Ahmedi, and Cengiz Chandar. Very much welcome, as always, to the Institute. Come back.